Okay, so, good afternoon. So this morning we started looking at polylogarithms, which are iterated integral defined in this way. And well, we said several things. We said, okay, they form a shuffle algebra. And we denoted this algebra by A. And we called the weight the number of integrations. And the main question we wanted to ask ourselves is, what are relations among these functions? So what are functional equations? Like the one we looked at, it looked like this. That's theta 2. So there are these relations of this kind, and we want to understand these relations because we need them when we want to deal with these functions. And then we started, so this is one thing, and then unrelatedly, at least up to then, we defined what a Hopf algebra is, or at least some notions that go in there. More precisely, we looked at co-product, which would be something, some linear map A that goes from a space to the tensor product of the space with itself, and it's co-associative, which means I can associative, which means I can iterate in any way I like. Okay, there's a unique way of iterating this decomposition to 3, 4, and so on. Okay? And we illustrated it with this example of having and also this had a property that it is compatible with the normal multiplication, where the multiplication on tensors, on this side it's a multiplication on tensors, happens component-wise. Okay, that's what we did this morning, and we briefly looked at this example of having words made out of letters, and then you write all possible ways of splitting the word into two, and that gives you a map delta that satisfies all the properties if the multiplication is a shuffle. Okay? So, just some notation. It will be useful later on to call, for example, delta index 1, 2. This will be the piece in this sum that has 1 here and 2 in what follows. Okay, that would be here something like this. Similar delta 2, 1 of A, B, C would be A, B, tensor C. Delta 0, 3 of A, B, C would be 0, which is 1, so that's a word of length 0, tensor the word of length 3. Okay, it's just some notation that is useful because I want to be able to pick out pieces in this sum. Okay. So what has all this to do now with this? Well, there's a theorem which goes back to Goncharov, which says that multiple polylogarithms, MPLs, multiple polylogarithms, form a Hopf algebra. Goes back to Goncharov. And of course, if I say that, then I have to tell you what the coproduct is. The product is clear. That's just normal multiplication, or the shuffle product. I have to tell you what the coproduct is. And, well, to write it down in terms of the G's is a bit tedious, because the G's is not a notation that the physicists use. Mathematicians have a slightly different notation, which will be useful, which is essentially the same. The only difference is that I allow myself to start the integration not from zero, but from some generic point. And I read the indices backwards. So the translation would be that GA1 ANZ, that actually corresponds to I0, I start from 0, and then I read them backwards, and then I have Z. It's just because this is, yeah, they're swapped. It's just convention, but it's useful to write down a general formula. So, the general formula for the coproduct, I'm going to write it down now once, and then we'll quickly forget about it. So, delta of I, well, I think it's clear to everyone that the I's and the G's essentially span the same space, okay? Even though the integration starts from zero, but I can always split the integration from A0 to AN plus 1 to the integral from 0 to AN plus 1 minus the integral from 0 to A0. So in the end, I get the same space. So, if I give you the formula for the delta of I, then I also give you the formula for delta of G, obviously. And the formula is the following. It's a sum I k plus 1 plus n over partitionings of 1 to n. And then in the first factor, k tensored with the second factor, the product from p equals 0 to k of a index i index p, a index I index p plus 1, all the way to a index I index p plus 1 minus 1, A index I index P plus 1. No, plus 1. Yeah. It gets very involved. The good thing is we will not need a formula. There's a shortcut to it. But this is the formula, just in case you want to know what the general thing is. It's also good to appreciate that this is not an empty statement. Because you have to prove now that this formula satisfies this, and so on. Okay, so it's not just, yeah, Poulenc's formula in Hopf-algebra, yes, that's nice to say, but you have to prove that this general formula satisfies all these conditions, which I guess you can feel is not trivial. So what does this formula mean? As I said, we don't need it. No. Here it is said, here it is not. You will see why when there's a geometric picture or a combinatorial picture, then you see why. So, let's look at an example. Let's start from zero, just because This would be G, B, A, Z. The way to memorize this formula is the following. Draw a semicircle. You start at zero, you end Z, so those are the two endpoints, and on the circle are A and B. Okay, so this is precisely what I have in my eye. Now what I do is, I sum of all possible ways of putting a polygon inside. For example, this would be one way to put a polygon inside. Okay, with the base, which is zero Z. Then the first term in here is precisely I. Then I follow the polygon. I start at zero, A, but then I immediately go to Z. And then the product on the other side is precisely the things that I left out. So here it would be the first one, it would be a polygon that starts at zero, but then there's nothing in between, I immediately end at A, and this by definition is one. Because there's no index in between, this is what we had also the other day when someone asked the question, what is this? This we defined as one, that's the same as this thing. And there's another one, which is, you start from A, you go to B, and you end up at Z. So you start at A, you go to B, and you end at Z. That is one term in the sum. And there's, of course, other ways of doing this decomposition. It should be this. That's not a polygon I couldn't put inside my semicircle. Now the first factor, I start at zero, I go to B, and I end at Z. Well, the second factor, I start at, the first term is I start at zero, so this is here. Start at zero, go to A, and I end at B. And then the second one is, I start at B, and I immediately end at Z, which is one. There's another possibility, which is this. And now obviously the first one is just zero A, B, Z, so the full thing. And on the other side, you have, well, I guess you can see it's one. The first one would be from zero to A, but there's nothing in between, which is one. Then from A to B, there's nothing in between, which is one. From B to Z, nothing in between, so it's one. Which is similar to what we had in the example of the words. One way of decomposing an object is not to decompose it at all. But there's another way of not decomposing an object, which is to do this. I say, okay, I go from zero directly to Z, which is one, and then everything that is left is the full thing. Okay. So this picture is just, you draw all this formula is just, you draw all possible semicircles and you sum up all possible polygons inside your semicircle. That is the combinatorial picture. Which ones? Okay, maybe let me do the one with three, A, B, C, then it's more obvious. This one is maybe, it's trivial, but maybe too trivial to see what happens. So, what happens, let me say it here and then we do the other one. You have to, whenever you have to basically construct now all the polygons whose base is a given edge. Here the only one you can, there two. There's one which is the trivial one from zero to A directly, but there's nothing in between, so it's just a degenerate straight line. That is the first term. And the second one is the one whose base is this, which is a triangle, which has 3 points, which is A, B, Z. Okay? Yeah? Well, slowly. No, it must be in the right order. That is the whole point of having the semicircle. And also you see here the A's are ordered, they are not orderless. So let's look at the one with 3 indices and then I think it's clearer. Yes, let me first do the other one and then I comment on that. So here there's one term. It would look like this. This would be 0, A, Z. Then this would give me 1, and the other one would give me from A to B, C, Z. And then I have, of course, another one which looks very much the same, looks like this, B, A, C, 0, Z. And now I have from 0 to C, and then to Z. And then here I have 0 to A, B, and then and in C, and then from C to Z gives me 1. And then the interesting one is this one. So the first factor is this. The second one is the product of this polygon and this polygon. Okay, so there's a first polygon where I start at 0, go to A, and end in B. And I multiply it by the other polygon which starts at B, goes to C, and ends in Z. So then you get really the product. And of course, now I have to add many more. I also have to add these things. Okay. Which are again simple. This would be 0, A, B, Z, tensored with this is 1, this is 1, and then there is this one from B, VSC to Z. I have this one, which is pretty much the same, but it's just a reflection of it. I 0 B C Z tensored with this thing, which is I 0 A B. And I have also this one. And then here you have this. Okay? And then there are, of course, the two trivial ones, the one where I have connect all the points, which would give me A, B, C, Z, tensor 1, and the empty one, which gives me 1, A, B, C, Z. Okay? Is the general construction clear? You have to write down all these polygons, and then you can read off what it is. It's just combinatorics. Now, The question, what happens when two points are the same? I will not discuss that in detail. I refer it to literature, because that gets now very technical, and we won't need it for the rest of the lecture. Sorry? Yeah, I can tell you later, for those who are interested, let me just mention that indeed there is an issue when two points become the same. Effectively, what you do is you have to regulate. Say B is equal to A. What you effectively do is you do this, and then you expand in epsilon. You would get divergent terms, and you kind of, well, not renormalize, but there's a way to remove the divergent epsilon terms in the end, which is consistent and everything. But I would need another hour just to set up the background for that. So let's not go there. But just to tell you, there is, you have to be careful. This formula is valid when all the points are different. If not, then it becomes technical. But for the rest of the lecture, we don't need that. We just need a kind of distilled version, which would be the log, which, when you play this game, becomes this. Remember that the log, this is G0z. Okay, so the log itself has a coproduct. And it is that. This is what you would expect. This means that the log is kind of, well, it is literally what is called a primitive object. The logarithm is the building block out of which you construct all the others. So the logarithm you cannot decompose in any non-trivial way. That's what this means. Well, you can also show that this one, which is, remember, minus g 0, 0, 1, so n minus 1 zeros, z, this has also a nice closed form. Minus 1 minus k z tensor log to the kth power of z divided by k factorial. So there you see it's non-trivial. The polylog itself has a non-trivial decomposition. You can prove this formula using these semicircles and a bit of this issue, because here you would have many of them that are the same. But it's pretty much what this formula is essentially, there would be plenty of zeros all the way, and then a one. It would be the sum of all possible ones that look like this. Because this would be something like I is 0, 0, 1, z, tensored with a 1, that's not this one, sorry, which one is it? Ah, no, it starts with a 1, sorry. The G's and the I's are reversed, so it starts with the 1. And then stuff like this, 1, 0, 0, which is the same as G, 0, 0, 1, Z, and on the other side, you would have other zeros, which end in a Z. So this would be something like G, 0, 0, 0, Z, which is a logarithm to some power. And then there would be others that vanish. For example, when you connect only zeros, you would get it would vanish if you do it. Okay, that's just a comment. But the formula we need is this one. With this, you can already do quite some stuff. For example, what would be delta of log x log y? Well, we know that the delta of a product is the product of the deltas. You get this. For each of them, we can use this formula. and you multiply it out component by component, and you get this. Okay. You just multiply it out term by term. Okay. So now this is all very nice, except that it has an issue. And the issue is the following. Take this formula here and let's go and put z equal to 1 in there. If it holds for generic z, it should also somehow hold for z equal to 1. And then you can easily check, well, the first, you know that li n of z is something you saw in the first lecture at 1. This is the Riemann zeta function, zeta n. So this means that I can now compute delta of zeta n as 1 tensor zeta n. And then the sum here, what does it give me? When z is equal to 1, all the terms vanish except k equal to 0. So you get this. So you get that all zetas are primitive. But on the other hand, you know that, for example, zeta 2 is pi squared over 6, and zeta 4 is pi to the 4 over 90. All the zetas for even n can be written as powers of pi. That goes back to Euler. Very old result. So in particular, I conclude that zeta 4 is actually proportional to zeta 2 squared. And the factor in between is, I always forget what the factor in between is. Factor in between is 2 over 5. Okay, so far so good. But that means that I should be able to compute delta of zeta 4 as 2 divided by 5 delta of zeta 2 squared. And so when I do that, I get 1 tensor zeta 4 plus zeta 4 tensor 1 plus 4 divided by 5 zeta 2 tensor zeta 2. I get a double term, okay? And when you compare the two formulas, they are not the same. So there is an inconsistency in this thing. Because I compute the same object in two different ways and I get different answers, so it's inconsistent. Now, the reason for this is, well, it's pi, right? It's kind of monotomies. It's discontinuities. And actually, when I said that Gontcharov showed that multiple polylogs form a Hopf algebra, the actual statement is multiple polylogarithms modulo zeta 2 form a Hopf algebra. For precisely this, or modulo I pi, if you want. Modulo discontinuities. Because discontinuities screw the picture. You can, however, resolve that simply by saying this. Now, this looks very ad hoc and very innocent, but it's very, very deep. Well, first of all, you should note that with this formula, basically, the problem doesn't arise. What it effectively means is that I pi is only exists in the first factor. More correctly, what I do is I actually define H SA modulo I pi. Take pi out, say pi is 0 inside h. H is a Hopf algebra. On h, everything I told you is true. Now reconstruct this in the following way. I now say pi is not part of my Hopf algebra, but pi is a coefficient. And what happens then, my delta actually starts from A and will go to A tensor H. This is something called a coaction. It's no longer strictly speaking a Hopf algebra because it's asymmetric. But it's a something called a coaction, but think of it as a Hopf algebra, that's good enough. If you want to know, if you remember this, I told you this morning, everything that starts with a co has to do with a dual, this is a dual to a group action. If you want to know more about that, we can talk about it later, but for the sake of the discussion, think of it as a Hopf algebra, which has this special rule that whenever pi appears anywhere else than in the first factor, you just throw it away. And we'll see that in examples. With this rule, obviously, this issue is resolved, because now zeta 4 will be zeta 4 tensor 1 and nothing else, because the second factor, which had zeta 4 here, would live in h, and in h, pi is equal to 0. That's really the way you should think about h. H is the same as a, but pi is defined to be 0. The first time you hear it, it sounds a bit weird, but mathematically I can do that. On the other hand, this thing, which is supposed to be the same, will be 2 divided by 5. And now, also zeta 2 will have the same structure. So I get the same as what I had here. Okay, because the square of this will be zeta 2 squared tensor 1. And then I go back to zeta 4 tensor 1. Okay. You will see in examples what happens. It looks very strange and very ad hoc almost. For example, people often ask, why did you choose IPi tensor 1 and not 1 tensor IPi? The same argument would go through. You will see the examples, it would all break if I had chosen 1 tensor IPi. So there is much more than what I just gave you. This is kind of the motivation where you see that pi is special, and also in the examples. But it's more than just a stupid rule to deal with pi. It's something very deep, related to discontinuities and so on. Okay. Before we look at examples, this works in all cases. Yeah, this works always. I mean, I concentrate on these guys because you can work out the formulas on the board. If you work with the G's, just writing down what the coproduct is takes the full blackboard, so... Okay. Before we look at examples, maybe we can directly look at an example. That's probably more helpful. Well, check how I did it in my notes. Yeah. Let's first look at something else, which only takes 5 minutes, and then we look at examples. It will also help to clarify this issue. As you see now, the whole picture has become asymmetric. There's the left factor and the right factor, which actually look different. Okay, one knows about pi, the other one doesn't. In the right factor, pi is equal to 0, and the left factor, it's not. And as I said, it's actually very deep. And the reason is that the left factor knows about discontinuities, while the right factor does not. And vice versa, the right factor knows about derivatives, while the left factor does not. Let's look at some example. For example, we saw this morning that discontinuity, so the Li 2 has a branch cut starting at 1, and discontinuity across the cut is something like this. I'm not going to discuss plus or minus, it depends on your choice of branch cut, but, well, choice of Riemann sheet, but the discontinuity is something of this type. Okay? So, what is the co-product of Li2 of Z? Well, there are the two trivial terms. And if you work it out, using the formula that I gave you, it looks like this. Okay? Now, what is, let me take the discontinuity of everything in the left factor, in the first factor. So obviously, 1 has no discontinuity, so that vanishes. Li 2, well, that is, if you take the discontinuity across the branch cut at 1, the formula above is. Okay? And the last one, that gives me, there's a minus, but here I also get, I get minus, minus 2 pi I. Why do I get minus 2 pi I? Because if this thing had plus I 0, minus it would have minus I 0, so I switch the branch. So, okay, so I can recombine it and say this is plus 2 pi I, and I put a plus in front. And what is that? Well, let's compute the delta of the thing on the right-hand side of the discontinuity. Well, my rules tell me this should be delta of 2 pi I times delta of log Z. And this gives me 2 pi I tensor 1, that's my special rule for pi, times log, but the log has no special rule, so that gives me this. And so when you multiply it out, you see that this thing gives you precisely this. Can you see that? If you multiply it out term by term, you get 2 pi I times 1 tensor 1 times log Z, which is the second term. And the first term is 2 pi I log Z tensor 1 times 1, which is this term. Okay? So there you see that the fact that 2 pi I was in the first factor is not arbitrary. It's related to the fact that the first factor actually knows the discontinuities. And I pi is a discontinuity. The general statement is that the co-product of a discontinuity of a function would be the same as only acting with a discontinuity in the first factor of the co-product. That's the general statement. Which is quite remarkable. And we'll see this as is very important also for our amplitudes. So, now, this gives a meaning to the first factor, to the left. That's the discontinuity. What is the meaning of the right factor? Well, remember that Li 2 of Z was defined in the following way. So from this I get that d over dz of Li 2, so I get the differential equation for Li 2 essentially. And so let me now compute the co-product of, well, let me do the same here. But now I take, instead of taking this continuity in the first factor, I take the derivative in the second factor. So here the first one, first factor, gives one tensor the derivative of Li 2, which is this. Here, well, derivative of 1 is 0. And in the last one, I get minus log 1 minus z tensor, the derivative of log z, which is 1 over z. Now, I can pull out, of course, a minus. 1 over z is a rational thing in general, so let's pull that out as well, because the whole thing is linear with respect to rational numbers. And I guess you can easily see that this is the co-product of the thing on the other side of the derivative. So there's an equivalent statement to this one, which says that the co-product of the derivative of a function is actually the same as taking derivative of the function only in the second factor. Again, here it looks trivial, but then same comment as what was made before. This thing, for example, also holds for the G's. You could now, but this thing would hold for every partial derivative of every g with respect to any kind of variable. Okay? Also a, b, c, whatever. It's a very generic statement. So this gives you a feeling for what the left factor and the right factor are. They are derivatives and discontinuities. And also gives you a feeling why this rule for I pi was what it was, because it's related to discontinuities in the first factor. Okay, so I guess it's time for some examples. This was all dry theory, unless you have general questions about the theory. No. Well, not in general, because it will work if you only have one variable. I mean, then you can, when I tell you this, you can immediately reconstruct Li 2. However, imagine you have two variables. Then, well, let's take the simple example of what we had before, the product of log x and log y. It would contain with terms that looks like this. So the delta 1,1 of this thing, delta 1,1 of log x log y will be log x tensor log y plus log y tensor log x. Okay? Now, if I differentiate, say with respect to x, in the second factor, I would kill this term. So you lose information in general. Of course, if you have some kind of boundary data, you can reconstruct it possibly, but there's no nice and neat formula like this one. Nonetheless, I should say that all this actually comes from integrals. I'm not going to discuss that. I can tell interested people later. It comes from some very general theory of iterated integrals, and there, this thing is there. These tensors have a much deeper meaning than what I discussed here. Okay, so now all this is very nice, but I haven't told you what you can do with it. The idea is that, let's write this down because that is actually the main thing. All functional equations come from the Hopf algebra. So what do I mean by this sentence? You have all these complicated relations among the functions. The idea is that if you have a complicated relation, you could act with the coproduct and decompose it into pairs of objects of lower weight, which are simpler. Okay? For those, you might know the relations, and you actually see that the relation just follows from there. If not, well, then you can act again with the coproduct and decompose into three pieces, which all have lower weight. And you might know the relations among these simpler objects, and the relation follows from there. If not, you keep on going until you decompose everything into objects of weight one, which are logarithms, which you know completely. So in that sense, everything builds up recursively from the logarithm and the combinatorics that is in here. Okay? We'll see that. But that's the main idea, and that's what I said this morning. The picture you should have in your head, although that's not a rigorous mathematical picture, is that the relations among these functions are kind of a concrete realization of some abstract algebraic thing, which is the combinatorics that is in this coproduct. And the building block, which is the logarithm. And from there you build up the whole thing and all the relations. Let's look at an example. Let's first look at a simple example and then, well, all the examples will be relatively simple enough that I can work it all out on the board, but let's start with one which is almost trivial. Let's assume I give you an expression t, and this expression looks like this. Okay? And I can ask myself, can I write this thing in a different way? Maybe simpler way. Now, there's a caveat here, which is that simple is a matter of taste. Okay, simple might mean many things. It might mean the lowest number of terms, it might mean the simplest possible functions, and sometimes these two statements don't commute. Okay? In general, however, there is kind of a, well, human sense of what you call simpler. But mathematically, we're talking about writing expressions in different ways. So mathematically, they're all the same. There's no notion of one is simpler than the other. It's the same function. Okay, bear that in mind, because sometimes that confuses people why what comes out of here is supposed to be simpler than the other one. It is the same function, just written in a different way. So, this is a weight 2 object. What I can do with it, I can decompose weight 2 into two objects of weight 1. This is my delta 1,1 of t. So I compute delta 1,1 of V21 minus Z plus delta 1,1 log Z log 1 minus Z. And we've had this thing now many times. This gives me minus log Z tensor log 1 minus Z. You use the same formula as before, but you replace Z by 1 minus Z. And this is the same as what we have over there, plus log Z tensor log 1 minus Z plus log 1 minus Z tensor log Z. And I guess you can all immediately see that this term cancels this term, and you're just left with one term. And you can also see rather easily that this term is the same as this one, up to sine and up to replacing z by 1 minus z. So this thing is minus delta 1 1 of li 2 of z, or delta 1 1 of minus li 2 of z. This is a very trivial example. Now, what do I conclude from this? Well, what I conclude from it is that t must actually be equal to minus li 2 of z. Yes or no? Well, I could add anything such that delta 1, 1 of c vanishes. Okay, there could be a non-trivial kernel. And there is. We know that. There are all these zeta values that are primitive, that I cannot decompose. So in particular, here midway 2, c should be something like a multiple of zeta 2. That's all there is. Those are basically zeta 2s. To be honest, I think no one has ever proved what these primitive elements are, but in practice they are zeta values. So, I can fix everything up to this, if you want, boundary value, which you can, however, get by looking at special points. So, for example, at z equal to 1, the left-hand side gives me li 2 of 0, which is 0, and here I get, well, log of 1 times log of 0, but the log of 1 wins. The limit z going to 1 of this thing vanishes, so I get 0 equals minus zeta 2 from the first term, plus c, which is k zeta 2, so I get k equals 1. And if you go back in your notes, this is precisely the relation that I had written on the board several times. I asked you how I would prove it. Well, this would be one way to prove it. But I have not used any kind of analytic information. I did not use the integral representation or the differential equation for li 2. I just used combinatorics. Okay? And that is the kind of guiding principle. It's all just down to combinatorics. If you want 5 minutes break, now is a good point, unless you have questions, because the next example is a bit longer. Okay? If there are no questions, then let's have a 5 minute break and then we go on. Okay, good. More questions? No more questions? Then let's look at a slightly more illuminating example. Let's look at the following. So, what I want to do is the following. Imagine I give you a positive real number. Okay, and actually, I take it bigger than 1, for the sake of the example. Remember that we said that li n has a branch cut which starts at 1 and goes to infinity. Okay, so whenever x is bigger than 1, I sit on the branch cut and my function is, well, first of all, I cannot sit on the branch cut, so let's replace x by x plus I0, so I sit just slightly above, but I develop an imaginary part. And so what this translates into is some analytic continuation formula that looks like this. Li 1 over x must be equal to something which is real plus 2 pi I times the imaginary part. Okay, and what we're going to do now is we're going to derive these formulas for n equals 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, of course, I'm not claiming that this is any new deep insight because you can find all these formulas on Wikipedia. It's just about see how it works, okay? Because the same strategy would also work for more complicated functions. Okay, so let's start. We do this, so this means that actually log minus x plus I zero, this is log x, which is positive, minus I pi. Okay? Good. Now, let's look at the case n equals 1. E1 of, let's turn it around and I choose x between 0 and 1 because it's easier to write down. Then 1 over x is bigger than 1. It's the same as before, but I just turn it around. So this is log 1 minus 1 over x. And there you see the problem. When x is less than 1, then 1 minus 1 over x is a negative number, so I get an imaginary part. But what I can do is the following. I can write this as minus log 1 minus x plus log of minus x. This is obviously the same. But log minus x, I have it here, so this is log 1 minus x plus log x minus I pi. Okay, so far I've not done anything particularly deep. Well, if you want, I can also write this as Li 1 of x plus log x minus I pi. Okay, so this is my analytic continuation formula for Li 1. Now let's go to Li 2. So Li 2 of 1 over x equals what? So either you go to Wikipedia and you know the answer, or you try to do it yourself. Well, this is a weight 2 object. Well, if it's weight 2, I can decompose it into two objects of weight 1. I can look at its image of under delta 1, 1. This is minus log 1 minus 1 over x, tensor log 1 over x. This is the formula we had all the time. But now, what you see is, in the weight 1 part, I get precisely the thing that I had before, because it's recursive. So this gives me minus, and, well, this minus log 1 minus x is actually the full thing. So this is minus log 1 minus x plus log x minus I pi. Tensor, and log 1 over x is minus log x. Okay? So, I write it out. It gives me minus log 1 minus x, but I have minus minus, so I get a plus. Tensor log x. I have another term which is plus log x, tensor log x. And I have a last term which is, I have a minus sign here. Yes. And I have a last term which has a plus, plus I pi log x. Tensor log x, sorry. Now, what are these things? The first one, you can see, actually comes from minus Li 2 of x. It is the same as this with x replaced with 1 over x and changing the sign. This, the second one, is precisely 1 half log square x. You can work it out. This is what it is. The last one is plus I pi log x, but only thanks to my special rule for I pi. If I had not had this special thing, I would never, if I had done it symmetrically, I would have also needed the term log x tensor I pi, which I cannot produce from here. So there you see another case where you actually need this very special rule for pi. And that you really need it. Okay? So, conclusion. V2 of 1 over x is equal to minus V2 of x minus 1/2 log square x plus I pi log x plus some multiple of pi squared, which I lost along the way. But what is k? Well, put x equal to 1. I get zeta 2 equals minus zeta 2 minus 0 plus 0 plus k pi squared. So this is, well, let's say it's a multiple of zeta 2. It's easier to do the algebra. So then actually k is equal to 2. Whether I put there pi squared or zeta 2, it's the same thing. Okay, so I get to the inversion relation for the L2 just from combinatorics. No integrals, no analytic continuation, no derivatives, nothing. Just knowing the starting point that the log of minus x is log x minus a pi and the Hopf algebra. Now you can go on. And actually now it's only now it gets interesting. So let's look at n equals 3. Now it gets really interesting. So L3 of 1 over x. I want the analytic continuation formula for that. The first thing I do is I look at, if you want, the crudest approximation possible to L3, which is delta 1, 1, 1. Which, if you use the formulas, becomes that. So there is now a triple tensor. If you remember the formula, there was a term that had a tensor log square at the end, which becomes log x log x. Again, I can plug in the first factor the term that I know, which is minus log 1 minus x plus log x minus I pi. And here, of course, sorry, this should be 1 over x here. But I can, of course, now invert each of them, and then I get minus log x from each of them, so the two minuses cancel, and I can just write log x log x. So I can multiply it all out. Plus log x tensor log x tensor log x minus I pi tensor log x. The first term you can easily check. It's the image of L3 of x. The same as this, with x replaced by 1 over x. This one, I guess, will not be surprised to hear that this is log cube of x with a 1 over 3 factorial in front, because there are 3 factorial ways of writing the log x. And the last term is minus I pi divided by 2 log square x. Okay, you have to sit down and work out the details, but it follows from the formulas that we've seen. So, well, let me call this, just so they don't need to write it, let me call this capital L. So what do I conclude from it? I conclude from this that L3 of 1 over x must actually be equal to L plus stuff, such that delta 111 of stuff is equal to 0. Now, before we said, okay, this thing is proportional to a zeta value. Here, this is not necessarily true, because here I'm decomposing already further. In particular, here, I could have, well, what do you think you could have here? I'm giving you a hint, it's not a constant. Well, if you want to, you don't actually need to guess, you can compute it. So, what you've done here is you started from a weight 3 object above, and you looked at its decomposition into weight 1. But there are things sitting in between. I could have decomposed 3 into weight 2 times weight 1, or into weight 1 times weight 2. And then decompose each of the weight 2 into weight 1 times weight 1. And cause relativity tells me that this thing is unique. Okay? So rather than jumping immediately back up, you should first try to figure out what happened in here. Okay? So let's try to do that. Let's look at delta 2,1 of Li 3,1 over x minus L, which is already the stuff that we know. So, if you do that, well, the delta 1,2 of Li 3, this will be Li 1 of 1 over x tensor log square x over 2, if you use the formulas. Then you can also do it for L, which is here. I just give you the answer. It will be minus, which is this minus here, and then there will be Li 1 of x tensor log square x over 2. Well, this is 1 over x, but it's log square of 1 over x is log x. Okay. Yeah, log square x. It's this term. Then there's a term which is plus 1 half log x tensor log square x, and then there's the term I pi over 2 tensor log square x. And you work out the details, but you see the structure. This is the first term is the same as this, with x replaced by 1 over x. Then the other one gives you log x, log square x, and you have to take down a 3, which gives you 1 over 2. And the other one is just I pi in the first and log square in the second. What you can do now is you can plug in the formula that you know for this in terms of Li 1 of x, and what you find is 0. With a bit of experience, this doesn't come as a surprise, because the things that you're after are things that are weight 2 and indecomposable, which is pi square. But pi square in the second factor is 0. So you must find a 0 here. Okay? But there's another thing, which is this one. That one is more interesting. Delta 2,1 of Li 3 of 1 over x minus L. And you work it out, you get Li 2 of 1 over x tensor log 1 over x minus Li 2 of x tensor log x plus 1 half log square x tensor log x plus I pi log x tensor log x. And you can compare it to this, it looks very similar, except that here, since I decomposed the square, I killed the 2, and here I swapped the 2. And if you now plug in the formula for Li 2 of 1 over x, which we already derived, and you change the sign because of that, then you get the following. Because our Li 2 here had a zeta 2 inside. If you look the formula, look at the formula that we derived, this thing had a zeta 2 over 3. Zeta 2 times zeta 2, which is not in this bit. You're left with this, which is the same as delta 2 1 of minus 2 zeta 2 tens log x. And so, Li 3 of 1 over x is this quantity that I called L, minus 2 zeta 2 log x, plus something that I cannot decompose. And here, strictly speaking, I have 2. I have now, say, alpha zeta 3. And I could also have beta I pi cube. If you look at x equals 1, you have to check what this thing is, but you get that alpha equals beta equals 0. Okay. So again, the upshot is I get this equation just recursively by knowing the Hopf algebra properties. No integrals, no derivatives, no contour deformations whatsoever. Computers. No, I mean, you can do these things up to, say, weight 5 or so. You can easily do it. And if you're very dedicated, people go to higher weights. Because it's algorithmic, that's the good thing. But of course, these examples are nice because you can work them out on the board. If you do it for the G's, just writing down all these things would be enormously long. So what you do is you have to code up all this stuff on a computer, but it's algorithmic and it's combinatorial. So it's precisely what you need for a computer. But a computer is bad at these things like integrals, where you have to figure out what it is. What a computer is good at is everything that is algorithmic and combinatorial. Okay? And so that is basically what I meant by functional equations follow recursively from the Hopf algebra. Okay, this is the prime example of what happens. And you see all the ingredients. You see the pi's that sit in the first factor but not in the second, and so on. And you could easily go, well, easily, it's a bit time consuming and tedious, but you could derive now the equation for Li 4 in exactly the same way. You would start with an object which has weight 4, and first look at its component 1, 1, 1. Then you would go one step up where you have 3, 1, 2, comma, no, sorry, 2, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, and 1, 1, 2. 1 level higher would have 3, 1, 2, 2, and 1, 3. And this one is connected to this one and to this one. This one is connected to this one and to this one. And this one is connected to here and to here. And they're all connected to this. And all these paths must give you the same answer, so all these paths must give you an identity, which give you constraints to fix all the terms. Yes. That's a good comment. Actually, the interesting one is the outer one, where you split off ones at the end. At least up to weight 4. Starting from weight 5, no, starting from weight 5, you have to think that we had in the board before zeta 2 times zeta 3, which you need to disentangle from zeta 5. But here it would, the interesting one is this one, these ones are empty. But formally you have constraints in all of them. Most of them will be empty. Okay. Yes, no, maybe. It's half past four in the afternoon, I know. Okay. Are there questions? So, if there are no questions, then this was the hardest part, okay? From now on, it goes downhill again. So, there's a small comment which one can make at this point. But just, yeah. Yeah. It's a good question. In principle, this should mean. The first question where this would come up with is, this is all tailored to polylogs, but I told you this morning there are these integrals that give you elliptic objects, where this does not apply, strictly speaking. Now, mathematicians very recently say that it can be done, but that is at the level of very formal mathematical statements, so not yet at this level where you would code it up on a computer and let the computer do the work. Okay? So, my answer to your question would be, maybe, but right now, the only one where you can really do it in practice, I can do it in practice, would be this case. Yeah? Okay. So, a small comment, something which people may have heard of or might hear. People often talk about what's called symbols. If you have understood everything I've told you, this thing is a piece of cake. It's simply that, remember, when I had to lead 2, well, when I have weight 2, I can always decompose it into weight 1. If I have weight 3, I can always decompose it into a triple weight 1, and so on. So this is the map delta that I call delta 1,1. This is the map delta 1,1,1. With weight 4, I can decompose it into quadruple ones. You want, this is the crudest approximation that I can make to my function. Crude in the sense that I lose something every time, like these zeta 2s and so on. Now, people often call this thing the symbol. So there's S, which is the same as this delta, with many ones. It's just the definition that people use. That is just decomposing into logarithms, the maximal decomposition. What people also do, because this thing is a decomposition into logarithms, you drop log. For example, what we had before was this. We said this is minus log 1 minus x, tensor log x. The way you often see it in the literature is that the symbol of the 2 of x is minus 1 minus x, tensor x. So people drop the log sign, because if you say it's weight 1 everywhere, every single entry has a log. So you might just as well drop it. It's just a notation. And don't get confused, this leads to very funny identities. This leads to identities of the following type. Whenever you have a 1 inside a tensor, this is a 0. Why? Because this 1 is actually log 1, and log 1 is 0. People also write down identities like this. Minus 1 is 0. Well, yes, because minus 1 is log minus 1, which is I pi, and I pi anywhere except in the first entry is 0. You also have funny identities like this. A times B inside the tensor now becomes A plus B. Okay, that's just a comment. Because you might see it in the literature. But it's really nothing but this maximal decomposition. One thing, however, which is useful and which people often use, and we'll also use it tomorrow, is I can now give you, I can ask the inverse question. I cannot say, okay, look, I take, well, if I tell you what the arguments of these logs are, this should kind of tell me what kind of functions I'm looking at. These are equivalent to the A's that appear in my G in some sense. So giving you the entries of the logs in the maximal decomposition in the symbol should also tell me what kind of functions I'm looking at. Sometimes people call these entries of the logs the alphabet. The alphabet, which is the entries in the symbol, or equivalently, the entries in the logs, and delta 111. It's again, it's jargon that you often find in the literature. For example, the alphabet of the classical polylogarithms, Li 2, Li 3, is x and 1 minus x. The only logs you've seen in the examples before were x and 1 minus x. And things like log of 1 minus 1 over x, which I can rewrite in terms of log x and log 1 minus x. But I can now ask the inverse question. Assume I give you an alphabet. I tell you, to be concrete, I have a function such that this thing, well, let's say like this. I tell you that I have a function whose symbol is this. Can you tell me what the function is? Yes. This is precisely the symbol of log x, log y. Plus possibly terms that vanish when I take the symbol, but okay. It's essentially log x, log y. What is the function whose symbol is x times y? No ideas? The answer is there's no such function. So in other words, if you write down a function, you can always find a tensor for it. But the inverse is not true. If I give you a random tensor, you will not find a function. So there is a strong selection, natural selection among tensors. And there's actually a theorem that says that, imagine I give you S, which looks like this. Let's call it I1 to IK. And, well, there will be some coefficients, which are rational numbers. And then let's call the entries in the symbol here something like this. Okay. This would be this or this with some coefficients. The C's are rational. CI. So if I give you such a tensor, then there is F such that the symbol of F is equal to S if and only if, it's bidirectional, the following identity holds, Casey. Plus one. Well, let's call it A. A plus one. IK. So I take these out. So when I put a head, that means I take it out. They're not there. But instead, I multiply by d log omega a wedge d log omega a plus 1. If I compute this thing and I get 0 for every a, then there is such an f. So this looks complicated, but what it means is I have to take out all possible consecutive pairs and replace them by wedge products of d-logs. So these are, d-log is a differential one form, and I can take a wedge product of them, and I get 0. For example, here, what I would need to do is, well, there's only one consecutive pair I can take, which are 1, 2, okay? That's all there is. So here, you have d-log x wedge d-log y plus d log y wedge d log x. So this thing is this, but I replace x, y by d log x wedge d log y. And this is obviously 0 because the wedge product is anti-symmetric. No, 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 no. Because you can imagine that if you have more variables, you could have your x minus y. Then this statement, these things start to mix. Because you could have, if x is a function of two variables, then x would, well, imagine x is a plus b, and y is a minus b, then all of them would give you dA and dB terms, so they start to mix. So it's really, it's a non-trivial statement. It is trivial if you just have one variable, because then there's no freedom. But in general, it's not trivial. And you obviously see that here this can never be satisfied. Here you get d log x, d log y, and that's it. Okay. Now, keep this in mind. This is what is called the integrability condition. It has nothing to do with integrability in the sense of what we do say in physics, but integrability in the sense of integrating the symbol to a function. Because this f is an integral of some sort. And this will come back tomorrow, because what we will do now is, we will say, okay, I have all this machinery. If someone, some divine creature, gives me the omegas that should make up my Feynman integral, or my amplitude, I can play games. I can try to write down the tensor and then try to reconstruct the function from its tensor. Okay, so rather trying, we will really literally guess functions tomorrow based on the tensors. So we're going to guess 3 and 4 loop functions. Well, guess is a strong word, but I guess you get the idea. Okay. You still have steam for another 10 minutes, or can have 10 more minutes, I guess, unless you tell me that you're dying. So, yes. Okay, so let's slowly move back to amplitudes. Tomorrow we'll look at an example, but in the last 10 minutes, we will already make some general statements about amplitudes. For example, imagine I compute some amplitude or some integral, and it gives me Pauli logs. Okay, and I assume it does. No elliptic stuff. Then, remember that we had this formula that the discontinuity, the co-product of a discontinuity, only acts in the first factor. So we had at the end of the previous hour. Now, if I'm really working with Feynman integrals or amplitudes, the discontinuities come from Katkowski's rule, or from unitarity, if you want. They are not random. This means that if you compute a co-product of something that is supposed to be an amplitude, the first entry cannot be random, because the first entry must be such that you reproduce all the unitarity cuts, no more, no less. Okay, this is very constraining. In particular, if you have massless amplitudes, which is what we were looking at in n equals 4, in the massless case, discontinuities or rather the branch points. So the branch points is the point where the branch cut starts. Discontinuity is what you get across. The branch points are points where Mandelstam invariants vanish. This is unitarity. So if you combine unitarity now with this, you conclude that, well, let's look at an example. It's probably best explained in an example. Let's take this object here, A4, the four-point amplitude. It's a function of S and of T, the end of the day, okay? Where S is 2 times P1, well, let's call it P1 or P2, 2 times P1 or P2, or in dual coordinates, it's x1 minus x3 squared. I assume I'm in planar n equals for super young Mills, just to simplify discussion. And T is 2 times P2, P3, which is x2 minus x4 squared. There's another invariant, U, which is minus S minus T, but so, in principle, you could have branch points in these three places. This is 2 times P1, P3. Given that the theory is planar, this thing would be non-planar. This is P1, P3. This is P1, P2, P3, P4. S is the channel where you have these two in the initial state, and say you have a cut like this. The cut in T would be the cut in P2, P3, the energy flows like this. There will be no cut in U in the planar case, because that would be like swapping these two, it would be non-planar. Okay? So you know that this thing has cuts in S and T. So branch cuts that start at S equals 0 and go to S equals infinity, and similarly when S and T is equal to 0, and it goes all the way to T equals infinity. That means that the symbol of this thing, just to make it simpler, use a symbol, must have the following structure. Because the first factor here, well, it consists with my own notation, I should write it like this. I said when I talk about symbols, I don't write log, but it's the same, okay. The first factor can only be such that it has the discontinuities of an amplitude, because otherwise this formula would not hold. And so the first factor can only be S and T and nothing else. And here all hell can break loose. That can be very complicated. And you have seen these x plus and x minuses. Okay, they will give contributions to these other stuff. However, well, let's look at that case when you have R6-2, this complicated thing. Unitarity tells you that its coproduct or its symbol must take the following form. The first entry can only be a cross ratio. It can only be Mandelstam invariant, and then by conformal invariants only a cross ratio. So all this complicated stuff that is x plus x minus must happen somewhere deeper in the symbol. Okay? This is a very general statement that I can make just based on this. And so if you now think of playing games where you say, well, if some God-given creature gives you, divine creature gives you an alphabet, write down a guess for the symbol, well, you already know the starting point. And if you also remember what this R6-2 looked like, it was Lie force, was weight 4. So there will be in total 4 entries. So the symbol of this thing should look something like that. Just based on what we've seen so far combined with unitarity. Yes? This is something called the first entry condition. It's basically just, if you want, reformulating unitarity in this language. Okay, so and from the last 3 minutes, another general statement, which relates to the fact that this was Lie force. And remember I told you that when you look at this function, there's the question, why is it force all over the place? Now I can rephrase the question in a slightly sharper way. Why is this thing a function of weight 4? Okay? There's a general conjecture which, well, if your amplitude of your integral is polylogs, so in dimension localization, say your integral will be something like this. Your amplitude will have a structure like this. Called AK. And K starts from 2L and goes to infinity in dimension localization. Then the weight, so if AK can be written in terms of polylogs, then the weight of AK is 2L plus K. Sorry, it's less or equal than 2L plus K. In particular, in n equals 4 super young Mills, that for some reason that I don't think you understand, maybe other people have other opinions, the bound is saturated. So in n equals 4 super young Mills, you know what weight every term has. This will not be true in other theories like UCD, that it's only an upper bound. In theories like UCD, it would not just be weight 4, but it could also be weight 3, weight 2, weight 1, all the way down to rational numbers. Okay? So in particular, this means that in n equals 4 super young Mills, one loop amplitudes have weight 2L, because then k is equal to 0, if I'm really in 4 dimensions. Okay? Then I take k equals 0. Two loops, I have weight 4. Three loops, I have weight 6. Four loops, I have weight 8, and so on. Okay, this explains why here I need 4 entries. If I want to do R6-3, I need 6 entries. It will be the same structure with 6 entries, and the first 3 things will be the same. That's unitarity. And how to fill the other slots, that's what we're going to see tomorrow and on Friday. Okay? Questions? No, it's never proven. Yeah. It's not even clear that it will actually be true because of these elliptic things, which will kick in at some point. This is a statement about polylogs. Now, then the question is, if you reach the point, which we eventually may, where polylogs are not enough, what is this, the content of this conjecture? Where we don't know what the weight is. But then the fact that there is something like a bound that is saturated means there must be some kind of meaning to it. It's too systematic not to be true. Okay. Good. Then I see you tomorrow.